If you would stand with us, I'm going to open us up with a scripture, and we're going to begin our worship this morning. It says in John 15:11, I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. So as we sing this morning, we're going to open with joy to the world, unspeakable joy.
Thank you.
faith in the name of Jesus, this man was healed. And you know how crippled he was before. Faith in Jesus' name has healed him before your very eyes. Friends, I realize that what you and your leaders did to Jesus was done in ignorance. But God was fulfilling what all the prophets had foretold about the Messiah, that he must suffer these things. Now repent of your sins and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away. Then times of refreshment will come from the presence of the Lord, and he will again send you Jesus, your appointed Messiah. What more could you even want for Christmas this year than to have a time of refreshment because you've come to Jesus? Something to share with our families this coming week and as the new year begins. Getting our lives straight first and then being that witness and sharing that gift with others.
Yeah.
last song. We're going to do the drummer boy, and we have a video to go with it. But I was looking up like the story for this, the narrative to this is a poor young boy. He was summoned by the Magi to the Nativity of Christ, and without any gifts for the infant, the little drummer boy played his drum for him because that's all he had. And it made me, of course, had me thinking, well, giving gifts to people, of course, so often we forget that it's not about how much money we spend on it, but it really is about why you wanted that gift for that person, the thoughts that were behind it. But then what about what we give to Jesus? Because you can't impress him. You can't spend the most at Christmas for your gift for Jesus and think you're going to get anywhere with that. John 6:29 says, Jesus told them, this is the only work God wants from you. Believe in the one he has sent. And then Matthew 22:37, Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. See, God, all he wants for Christmas, all he wants any day of the year, is simply all of you. And he has given each of us a gift. He's given each of us a talent. And what he wants is for us to use that talent to work his kingdom, to share the gospel with others, to be a blessing, and to lead people to the foot of the cross. So as the little drummer boy, he gave all he had. That's all God wants from any of us. Give all you have.
Oh,
thankful for this holiday season, Lord. We thank you for Christmas. We thank you for the meaning of Christmas, Lord. Lord, just knowing that you left all that you had there in heaven, Lord, to come to this world. And Lord, you did it for us. And I do pray, Lord, that we would self-evaluate this week, Lord, that we would look at where we're at with you in our service to you, Lord, that we would look at what we're doing with those gifts and those talents that you've given us. Lord, that we would realize, Lord, that we cannot impress you, but we just need to give all of us to you, Lord, so that you can use us. And Lord, I pray that once we do that, Lord, that you'll then move and work in our families and our friends, our workplaces, Lord. Help us to be a true testimony of what you can do in a person. And help us to lead other people to you, Lord. Lord, I pray for our families. Lord, I know there's families that are going through some health crisis, Lord. We have families that have lost loved ones. We have families, Lord, that are going through financial struggles. Lord, there's so much going on in all of our families that are represented in this building, Lord. And I just pray for each and every one, Lord, and that no matter what, that we would take time just to be thankful for where we're at, what we do have. Lord, help us to be content with what you've blessed us with. We love you so much. We just pray for the rest of the service, Lord. Please be with Brother John, be with our teachers that are going to be teaching the children, Lord. I just pray for your name to be glorified and that we will walk out this building today, Lord, feeling blessed and having met with you. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
I want to go through the bulletin just briefly. A couple things going on this week. Again, some changes, so if you can help make note of that. This Wednesday night, we will have our Candlelight and Communion service. That's this Wednesday night, Candlelight Communion service. That will start at 6 p.m. We'll meet all in here together. Then if you wouldn't mind bringing some refreshments, not a full-out meal, just some refreshments, and we'll share after service in the fellowship hall. This Tuesday, between 2 and 4, if you can help Miss Barbara at the food pantry, that will be available. I think all the kids are out of school, so maybe we can have some of our young people help out. Don't want to overload too many people, but make sure Miss Barbara has some help there. Don't forget this coming Thursday, unless rain is crazy again and it cancels again, we will have our Christmas parade here in Chipley. We do have a float. We'll have a trailer. It's a plan right now. We won't have a boat this year, but we'll have a trailer, some chairs. We have candy to give out. We have information about our church. But most importantly, we have the gospel to give out. So please come be a part of that. As soon as I find out exactly when we can redecorate that, young people, I'll put that out to our family or on Facebook, okay? But to line up, we need to line up at 5:30. Is that right? Line up 5:30? Was it 4:30? Lineup is 4:30, not 5:30. 5:30 is when it starts, I do believe. All right, so lineup is 4:30. You guys know we're lined up. It's over around the old football field. That's right. Okay. 24th, next Sunday, we will not have Sunday school. And everybody cries. No. We will not have Sunday school. We will start our morning worship service early at 10:30, okay? We'll have one combined service, no children church next week. We'll have just one combined service, okay, at 10:30. We will not have any service December 27th, and of course, we'll end off the New Year's, the 31st. We'll start around 5. We'll go until with games and refreshments, food you'll like to bring for our New Year's Eve party, okay, New Year's Eve game night. So at this time, we'll have our junior children church be dismissed. All our preschoolers can be dismissed. And now for our children's church. Children's church can be dismissed. Nate, if you need to pass that to somebody else to go help with children's church, you can. Whatever you need to do, bud, okay? I didn't realize are you working today back there? Okay, you're not? Okay, you're good. All right, cool. Oh, Zoe's working back there. Okay, got that. My bad. I didn't know. I should read the bulletin, right? I would know these things. Gary is starting to understand how hot it gets up here when you're teaching. He's starting to understand it, right, Gary? You guys freeze to death, but something about right here and right here, I kind of feel like it's the hot seat. So anyway, so I want to share something. I'm going to share it a little early. Gary's going to shoot me. But I am so excited that the First Real Baptist Church adult Sunday school teacher has been asked to speak at the National Association Sunday School class in Tampa 2024. So Brother Gary has been asked. He has accepted. He has accepted. He'll be speaking from the King James and the D6 curriculum. So I'm excited about that. So praise the Lord. So please, even now, be praying for Brother Gary. I had the opportunity several years ago to speak at the National. We've already discussed there'll probably be around 2,000 people there. That can be nerve-wracking to any speaker. So be praying for him, that God would work in and through him and of course, deal with the nerves and the fleshly side. But I'm really excited about that. It's really cool. So I'm very thankful for that. Him and Brother Eddie Moody, our executive director, has been playing phone tag for almost a week, right? So really excited about that. Well, if you have your Bibles, let's turn to Romans chapter 4. But just moving right along, Romans chapter 4 we're starting today. Now, based on time, I have two main points for today. I honestly believe only one point's going to get done today, and we'll do point two with Sunday service next Sunday with Christmas as well. I kind of feel like the Lord's leading that direction. I'm kind of hoping he is, because I feel like it'll fit really well. But if you remember, again, Apostle Paul was a Pharisee, and he was a Pharisee of the Pharisee, from a certain tribe, you know, circumcised on the eighth day, he was above reproach, he was someone special as a Pharisee. And then one day, as a Pharisee, he met Jesus, and Jesus changed his life forever. And he understands where these Jews come from. He understands because as a Pharisee, he probably taught and lived this out. So Paul does something really good. Again, we've seen from Romans chapter 1. Who remember what verses we've been talked about? One, what? Anybody remember what verse? 18, all the way to 3:20, right? Paul keeps saying the Gentiles and the Jews were all sinners. Then in chapter 3, verse 21, he walks into, and we need a Savior. Because Romans 3:23, for we all have sinned and fallen short of God's glorious standard. We talked about that last week. Well, he is helping them use what we call logic to really want to get a hold of these Jewish people to come to a true understanding of who Jesus is. And so he does something really unique starting in chapter 4. He's going to go and use someone who's very, 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 very important to the Jews. And many of us learned a song about Father Abraham when we were children. Who remembers the Father Abraham song? I won't go through it, but for those who are shaking your head, no, it went like this. Father Abraham had many sons, and many sons have Father Abraham. And I am one of them, and so are you. Especially if you're a follower of Christ. We'll talk about that here most likely next week or two. So let's just praise the Lord. And you went your right arm. Then you say the same thing again. Then you went left arm. Then your right leg. Your exercises in church, people. Some people might have called this electric breakdancing back in the 80s, you know. Then you get head up, head down, turn around, sit down. It was so much fun. We love that. I love that in children's church. Anybody else just love that? Who loved that as an adult with the kids? That's just fun. It's a fun song, okay. Miss Betty's like, hey, man, I like that. It's a good song. It's a lot of fun. The kids love it. So we'll have to just try that out. Game night. Remind me, New Year's Eve game night. You're here. We need to teach you guys Father Abraham. So he uses an Old Testament example. But not just one. He actually uses two. He used an Old Testament example of Abraham, but he also uses Father Abraham, the father of the faith. But he also uses another one, which is very, very important, particularly for those who understood prophecy, and that the coming Messiah, which again, a lot of these Jews, and many Jews who are not Messianic Jews today, still are waiting for the Messiah to come. But Paul understood the Messiah had already came, Jesus, that he was going to be of the line of, anybody remember what root of? King James says root of a certain man, a line of David, root of Jesse, right? From the line of David, right? So he gives illustration of not just the father of the faith, Abraham, the father of the nation, But he also gives the royal line, which everybody looked up to King David. Because, you know, Scripture said, you know, King David had a heart after God's own heart. So he uses two illustrations. And today we're going to look at Abraham. Verses 1 through 4. Abraham, first example, justification by faith. I heard a very interesting, let me take you back. I heard a very disturbing poll that was done in 2009. Now, some of you don't remember 2009, but to give you an idea, that was a year Hayden was born. Okay? That's how long ago that was, because she's so old. That's the inside joke. She calls me old like daily. But in 2009, Barna, the Barna Group, did a survey. Now, here's the survey. It was two. The question was, how faith varies by church size. Okay, that's what they're trying to figure out. How does faith vary by church size? Everybody with me? Here's the question. The question was, the question was asked to people who identified themselves, and I'm going to quote here, born again, are evangelical Christians. Here's the question. Can a good person earn a place in heaven? I see one person shaking her head no. Several shaking her head no. You guys are so smart. I want to ask it again. Can a good person earn a place in heaven? Now, this is going to be unique. By church sizes, here's the answer. Church size of 1 to 100, these are people who consider themselves born again, evangelical Christians. 67% of them said yes. Who is disturbed by that? Who's shocked by that? That's the worst. I'm going to be honest with you. This was actually shocking to me. The bigger the church got, the better it got. So bigger churches sometimes do a better job at teaching correct doctrine than smaller churches, according to the survey, at least in this one point. Here it goes. Churches size 100 to 200, 61% said yes, they can earn their way into heaven. Churches size 201 to 499, 53% says yes, a good person can earn his way into heaven. Churches size 500 to 999, 52% said yes, a good person can earn their way into heaven. And churches over 1,000 plus says 45% says yes, a good person can earn their way into heaven. Folks, the answer is zero. There is not one single person from Adam and Eve to any child that's been will be conceived can earn their way to heaven. Period. So if someone ever asks you that, and they're calling from Barna Group, and they actually get through your phone, it's not blocked, it's spam, and they ask you, hey, can a good person get, hey, I go to First Real Baptist Church in Chipley. No way! A good person cannot earn their way to heaven. No one can! You'll know the answer, right? That is the correct answer. No one can. Folks, there's only been one perfect person who ever lived by the law, and that's Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And only Jesus paid the debt that we all needed to be paid. So this is really unique because these Jews believe, as we talked about a couple weeks ago, just being from Abraham's line and being a part of the Jewish nation, that saved them. And if you remember, remember the Pharisees, some of them were very upset with Jesus. And they were like, well, who are you? We don't know. You don't know who your father is. Our father is Abraham. And he said, if you knew who my father was, you would know who I am and you would love me. But we don't love you. We don't know you. Our father is Abraham. And again, they put so much of their belief in that just being in the bloodline of Abraham got them into heaven automatically. All right, Romans chapter 4, verse 1. Paul says, Abraham was, humanly speaking, the founder of the Jewish nation. So he asks the question he wants them to think about. I want you to think about this too. What did he discover about being made right with God? I want to ask that again. What did Abraham discover about being right with God? Let's remember who Abraham was. Abraham was just a man around, you know, 65, 75 years old. He lived in Ur with his wife, his nephew, his servants, and his dad. And God says, I want you to leave your kindred people, and I want you to go through the land, I'll show you. Then God says, I want you to look up in the stars, count all the stars. I can't do that. If you would, count the sands in the sea. I can't do that either. Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of many, many nations. This guy's around how old around right now? About 75 years old, or a little bit 65 to 75 years old right now. Hadn't had any kids yet. They've tried, not happening. But the Bible says that he believed God what? That he would be the father of many, many nations. And through him, all nations would be blessed. Okay, everybody with me? So what he discovered about being made right with God? Scripture teaches us, and we'll look at this in a moment, that he believed God, and therefore God counted him to be righteous. Now, verse 2 says, if good deeds had made him acceptable to God, he would have had something to boast about. Now, for just a moment, some of our praise team members this morning were talking, and it's hard to remember things when we're younger. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Hard to remember young. For some of us, we block out bad things. Amen? Now, I'm going to tell them myself because that's what I do. But there's a time Miranda looked at me, Dad, you only share old memories that are really bad. Well, unfortunately, some of those bad ones just stuck in here. And I haven't been able to close them up very well. Some of you guys know what I'm talking about. But I want to have a little fun here. Let's pick on Abraham just a little bit. Let's talk about some of the bad things Abraham did. So who wants to give me one? What did Abraham do that was probably pretty bad? Say it again. Hagar had a child by somebody who was not his wife. He went the way of the world. He probably took her for a second wife. He shouldn't have done that. He did, exactly. 13 years before he had the son of promise. Absolutely. What else did Abraham do? Ooh, he lied. But whom did he lie to, and to whom did he lie about? He lied to a king? About whom? His wife. Now, wait a minute. It was a half-truth. Now, wait a minute, folks. It's a half-truth. And half-truth is a full lie. Because his sister was his half-sister, and that's just kind of messed up today. We know 400 years later when God gives this is going to be on a test for you to remember. Around 400 years later, this is going to be on test for you to remember. Around 400 years later, when God gave the law to Moses, you couldn't marry close relatives from that point forward. Okay? But before then, the gene pool had not been distorted as that bad yet. So he told a half-truth, which was a full lie. Anything else that you can think of he probably didn't do so good? He did it twice. I think his son even did it, didn't he? Something like that. Now, he did go and fight some really bad people to deliver his nephew, right? Some people say he probably shouldn't have done that. That's a different story. I disagree there. But there were some of the bad things he did, right? So why is this so important? Here we go. Paul knew the sentiment of the Jews of that day. They put Father Abraham, but also the patriots as well, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they put him on a pedestal. Matter of fact, all three of them on a pedestal. I want to tell you how much about this. This is crazy what I've learned. This was so eye-opening this week. I've talked to James and Gary both about what I learned this week. So they had a little preview, so don't spill it for everybody. But this was so good. I did a lot of deep studies in this. A matter of fact, there have been writings, not biblical writings. Let me say that. They are not biblical writings. They're part of the Apocrypha. There have been disproved for biblical use at all. But for hundreds and hundreds of years, matter of fact, I think, if I've seen it right, for about 1,500 years, they were believed to be true. And these writings actually said that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob did not sin, nor did they need to repent of sin. Who's shocked? For about 1,500 years, people believed that to be true. Until you really looked at the scripture and says, well, no, that's not accurate. A matter of fact, still today in the Catholic Bible, the Apocrypha, in the first Maccabees, I'll have to look up the exact chapter, I think it was 16, they actually showed that Abraham was saved because of his works. And they believed he was saved because of the work he did. That is still taught today in the local Catholic church because that's still their scripture. And the big aha for me is for any of our Catholic friends who I've had five or six very close ones in my life. if they would just read the scriptures or even their scriptures enough, they would see the contradictions in there. Go to say, Pastor John tells you to read your Bible, apply the Bible, memorize the Bible, and meditate on it. You guys, we've got to be in the Word. Number one, there may be a chance that some of our Sunday school teachers teach us something wrong. There may be a chance Pastor John does. I hope not. I'm going to try very hard not to. But we need to know the truth by reading the Word. Everybody with me? So for about 1,500 years, there were people who believed Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob didn't even sin. Now, I'll tell you where it's found. It was the prayer of Manasseh. Manasseh was one of the descendants of David. He was a very, 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 very evil king. He was part of the exile. When he was exiled, he repented. And Scripture says he prayed and repented. But somewhere around 1 to 200 A.D., 1st, 2nd century, someone wrote a prayer and called it his. And for about 1,500 years, they thought that was true. And in that 15 to 16 verses of prayer, they said that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob did not sin, therefore did not need to repent. So if this philosophy and theory, if the Jews thought this, I'm a child of Abraham. Think about the Pharisees and how they spoke to Jesus. I'm a child of Abraham. I know who my father is. Everybody got that? So Paul is trying to help them understand this logically. What did Abraham find out about good deeds? If his good deeds had made him acceptable to God, he would have had something to boast about. Second part of verse 2. But that's not God's ways. Now, I want to ask you to imagine with me for a moment. Now, if you need to close your eyes, you can. I got one or two already closing your eyes. I know it's getting easy, hot, warm off. Try not to nod off, okay? I know it's easy if you need to get up, move around, do so, okay? But listen to me for a minute. Try to imagine with me. So imagine this woman. She has worked very hard for over 30 years caring for those outcasts, those in the slums, the widows, and the orphans. And every day she's with them, she would sit beside them when they die and tell them how good and how much God loved and cared for them and how precious they were. And right before her death, she was asked this question. Imagine, the question goes something like this. Why should God let you into heaven? And this woman who has volunteered her time, carelessly cared for the outcast for over 30 years of her life, says, well, I've worked hard many years carelessly to serve others. And I have showed them how important they are to God. I have served Him by serving others. I hope that the work I have done is enough to have God accept me into heaven. Death comes her way, and she stands before God in judgment. And He cast her into hell for all eternity, for she never knew Christ intimately as her Lord and Savior. Sad, isn't it? Now imagine. Second scenario. Now imagine with me. You heard about this abuser, a rapist, a serial murderer who was tried and convicted and put on death row. As he waiting out his sentence for, we'll call it the electric chair, he starts reading anything he gets his hands on. And one day he reads the Bible. He gets his hands on a Bible and reads through the Bible, and he starts going to hear some lay preachers from every different types of churches come every single week and talk about God and talk about Jesus, talk about all kinds of great things. And he thinks, there's no way God would ever accept me because I've done so much terrible, wrong things. 6 hours before he's supposed to be executed, a minister comes in and speaks to him one last time. And this minister shares the gospel of Jesus Christ with him and tells him, even you can be saved. For if you would repent of your sins and put all your faith in Jesus, and Jesus alone, you can be saved. And that's exactly what this rapist, this abuser did. He repented of his sins. Within 5 to 6 hours later, he was executed. He stands before God in judgment. And God says to him, well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into heaven. Who would be honest and say, I struggle with those two stories? Me too. There's something about my flesh that wants, he deserved what he gets. God, that's so unfair. She gave her life for 30 years caring for people. I don't even want to go stand around. She loved to care for them, the outcasts, the orphans, the widows, those who lived in slums. But you see, the difference was she hoped her works would be accepted by God, and she hoped her works would be enough that God would let her into heaven. And this man on death row knew he had nothing to offer God, but he relied fully on the grace of Jesus Christ, and he repented of the murder, he repented of the rape, he repented of the abuse, and he put his faith completely, totally in Jesus, and he was considered righteous. You see, some of us struggle with that because we want those bad people to get what they deserve. And I'm not here to tick you off, but I look around this room, I see a lot of bad people, and we all deserve hell and its hottest flames. Well, I'm not as bad as that guy. Folks, there's things that go through my mind that is tempting. If you knew about it, it would drive you crazy. You wouldn't want me to be your pastor anymore. Truth. I have to fight it off all the time. Sometimes I don't fight it off very well. I shake it off. And I said, Lord, help me. I went too long with that thought. It could have been road rage. It could have been that guy deserved it. Man, judgment, sorry, revenge is mine, saith the Lord. Not mine, his, says the Lord. Not mine. There's days I want to interpret that. Vengeance is mine! I want to give that guy vengeance for what he's did. And if I'm not careful, I go directly to flesh and I do sinful thoughts about what I would like to do to people because they've done such wrong things. Everybody with me? Guys, we deserve hell. Just like that wonderful little lady who for over 30 years of her life volunteered her time for God, hoping he would accept her works or get her into heaven. I know that sounds terrible, but works don't get you into heaven. Now, folks, I've shared that story or something like that story many years ago, in a church I was pastoring, and I had people really mad at me. Because when you start to think about their grandmother or grandfather or their brother or sister who had died without Jesus, and they're just mad at me, you know they went to heaven because God's a good God. Folks, listen, as I said last Sunday off the camera, there is no doubt between me and 800, 1,000 years ago, I'm sure there's a lot of people died in my bloodline that don't know Jesus, that are literally in hell today. Literally in hell today. Some of my great, 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 greats, I'm sure, are probably literally in hell today. There's probably some of my family members today that will die and go to hell unless they repent of their sins and put their trust in Jesus. And they're alive today. And some of us are going to get to see them this week or next week. And we have the news they need to hear. They may not want to hear it, but they need to hear it. One more time. Just one more time. With love and concern and care about their final destination. Which without Christ, without fully relying on Christ's righteousness through faith, will be eternity in hell. That's their final destination. All right, let's go on. Romans. Oh, I got some more reading. Romans 4:3. And that's quoted from Genesis 5:6. For the scripture tells us, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of, what does that word say? His faith. Not his works. Not that he just walked away. He took his dad, his nephew, his wife, and all their belongings and walked away. He died. Dad died later on. He buried him, and he went on. It wasn't because of all those good things. He listened to God. He was obedient. Some of us can be obedient to God and still not be saved. How do I know? Well, Scripture tells us several times that God used some very, 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 very evil kings to do what he wanted them to do, to bring about his judgment. I still remember in my lifetime somebody was elected that I didn't vote for. And I still remember a very wise gentleman said, well, John, Pastor John, because I was his pastor, I was aggravated because somebody I voted for didn't get it. He said, how do you know that's not God's will for him to be the president? Oh, for him to be the elected official. Boy, that slapped me across the face. It really did. You're probably right. It's probably God's will for that one to be president. It's not what I want. Oh, sorry, I keep saying that. Doggone, elected official. It's probably God's will for that one to be there, although I didn't vote for him. Everybody with me? Sometimes God uses evil people to do his will. Our Sunday school class today talked about Joseph last week and this week. He had 10 brothers who did something pretty evil for him, to him. Anybody remember what they did, Joseph? They were going to kill him, first of all. They threw him in an empty, or maybe it might have had water in the well. I don't know. He didn't drown by it, but they threw him in an old cistern, old well. Then they sold him into slavery. Then he lied to dad and ripped up his really nice coat. Put blood all over it. They went and lived their lives. They were happy. They were pretty evil for that. Wouldn't you agree? Now, Jacob didn't do the best either. He showed favoritism. Hey, parents, don't show favoritism. Just don't do it. Don't go there. It ain't worth it. It can go on for generations. It's terrible. If you have multiple kids, say, I love each and every one of you very, very much. Just one a little more than the other. Now, don't do that. I'm kidding. Don't do that. You see, Paul knew the very word of God would then and now play a major part in a person's life. Because we know God's word won't return void. So Paul goes back to the scriptures and he quotes the scripture to them. Now, folks, let me tell you again, these are talking about Sadducees, Pharisees, and scribes. These were people, scribes literally wrote the word out daily. They were copy machines. A scribe was literally a copy machine. Think about the lawyers who knew the law of the Old Testament. How did they keep reading and read over and read over Genesis 15:6 and didn't get it? How when someone wrote a prayer of Manasseh, decades, centuries later, and said, oh, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob never even sinned. They didn't need to repent. How did they not balance that out with the rest of the scripture and say, no, that can't be right? Because all the scripture teaches differently. Abraham lied. Jacob was known as the liar. Hello? His name, deceiver, the heel. I mean, the heel is so bad, somebody don't eat the heel of bread. Have fun there. I love the heel of the bread, personally. Put a lot of mayonnaise on it. It's good stuff. He knew, speaking of the word, getting them to think logically. If Paul can help them understand that Abraham was counted righteous because he believed God, not because he did some type of ritual or even kept the law. You see, many people today will do the same thing. Well, I'm a member of so-and-so church. I can't tell you how many times the last probably 3 to 4 months when I just felt like God wanted me to talk to people. And I start talking to people. I ask, hey, getting spiritual beliefs, da, 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 da. You know, what do you think to you, who is Jesus? Are you connected to a church somewhere? Yeah, I go to church every week. Great, where do you go? Have you ever asked that question? And they literally just, yeah, I'm a member of so-and-so church. I go weekly. Really, where do you go? You ever ask that and they really can't tell you what church they go to? I've literally had that happen to me. Oh, really, who's your pastor? They would say the name. Who's the pastor? Can I just say something real quick? The panhandle was not super big. Everybody with me? Let me take it back. Gary, at one time, you had to do a survey for, what, 4 counties? How many churches was in those 4 counties 20 years ago? Over 400 churches. All right, let me have some fun here. Of those 400 churches, how many you think had multiple pastors in those 400 churches and couldn't keep up exactly what the pastor's saying was? Now, they probably have multiple pastors because they kept firing one and got another one. I'm kidding a little bit. You know, pastor quit, church fired. I mean, our church went through that. Well, anyway, we have history of that, too, many, many years ago before my time. My understanding, with an 18-month period, we had 3 pastors at one time or less than 18-month period. It can happen. I mean, it really can happen sometimes. Praise the Lord, it hadn't happened today. Praise God, right? But folks, listen to me. There's times I've asked people, literally it's happened the last 3-4 months. They keep telling me the name of the church they go to every week. Really? Then I really try to go deeper with Jesus. Or they go to church every week and they tell me the name of church, but they can't tell me the name of the pastor. Is the church that big or it has that many pastors? Or they change pastors that much that you can't even name the person who's teaching you the word of God? Hello? Or maybe you don't go there every week, but you just lied to me and told me you did. And they don't know I'm a pastor yet, so why not lie to me, right? I mean, it's amazing how many people straighten up after they find out I'm a pastor somewhere. I've talked to people that cussed their head off until they found out where I worked, and they, all of a sudden they cleaned it up real quick. Next time I see them, they forget I was a pastor. I forgot you're a pastor. Sorry, preacher. I'm like, you're cussing God's name, not mine. He's the one who's going to judge you, not me. Some people feel if they just follow the rules enough, if they can just be good enough. Well, if I become a member of this club, I've had people in my church who never became members of our local church because their club would not allow them to be a member of a local church because their club had to be the highest thing in their life outside of their local church. I've even had one that left everything that they owned to their local club. You guys are curious what clubs I'm talking about, right? I don't know, certain lodges, certain ones that look like this. And I know not everybody agrees with me. That's okay. But listen, I've had people who I was their pastor. I preached their funeral, and they would never be a member of the church because they couldn't do it. Now, to be a member of a Free Will Baptist church, like many Baptists, there's 2 requirements. Number one, you must be a born-again Christian. And you must be baptized by immersion under the water. That is basically your 2 requirements. Now, I would love, and I usually do, I try to have conversations with men and women before we be members of a church. Because what I have found in a couple of churches I've pastored, after talking with people who are members in the church, I found out, honestly, I don't think they were saved. I even had one, he was baptized because his kids got baptized. And he finally admitted, you know, 10 years later, he said, I don't think I was ever saved. I said, well, you need to get baptized. Well, I already got wet. Well, you weren't saved before. But folks, there's people who believe in the ritual. I was baptized. I got wet and everything. Or I was christened as a child. I was baptized into so-and-so church when I was an infant. All my original sins are gone. First of all, there's nothing in Scripture that teaches anyone should be baptized until they repent of their sins. And there's nowhere in Scripture and nowhere in my experience of 50 years that a little bitty baby can repent of their sins. Because a little bitty baby usually only cries and whines and lets out their food. Either this way or that way. Well, when the little ones come, what we practice is something called baby dedication. It has nothing to do with the child, but has everything to do with moms and dads and the grandparents. That they will raise a child in the way that God wants them to be raised. Just yesterday, we had a memory from 14 years ago of Zoe and Hayden's dedication. They were dedicated the same day of a couple kids in our church 14 years ago. Man, that was such a great memory. Aren't pictures great? They help you remember things you already hadn't thought about in a long time. I hate to use the word forgotten, but hadn't thought about in a long time. So as you're having conversations with families this week, they talk about, well, I'm a member of so-and-so church. I've been a member there 45 years. I've been a member there 2 weeks. I got baptized. And I've seen people who've been baptized who are completely 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 years later, living away from God, completely living in sin. and they think that baptism is their ritual that's going to get them into heaven. And somehow, some way, they didn't hear the truth, or they just didn't get it. Everybody with me? We're going to see more next week and more in a couple of weeks. And I'm going to just give you a highlight today. Here's a trailer of what's to come. You see, the Jews put so much weight on Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, particularly Father Abraham, and they did so much weight upon the law and the ritual. Remember what I talked about Paul? He was circumcised when? On what day? And Jesus even was blasted by the Pharisees. You're working on the Sabbath. And what did Jesus say? And you guys, if the eighth day of a new child, new boy is born, do you not circumcise him on the Sabbath as well? Do you not work on a Sabbath? You can't heal on the Sabbath. Well, you shouldn't be circumcising on a Sabbath. He didn't quite say it that way, but boy, I sure think that way. Good for the goose, it's good for the gander, right? Do you not realize the hypocrisy here, buddy? You tell me I can't heal? I can't heal the man who doesn't have has a wrong form hand? But you can circumcise on the eighth day? Well, that's fulfilling the law. I can almost hear Jesus say, I am the law. Boom! Mic drop. I'm the law. You know, here's another one. I am the Sabbath. Right? I'm sorry. This is so cool, okay? So what he's trying to get them to see, and again, here's a little foreshadow, hopefully not too much, but we'll talk about it again in a week or two. Paul's trying to help them understand that in Genesis 15, he was already considered righteous, and the law didn't come until about 400 years later. Here's another one for you. I'm going to give it away. I don't give it away too much. It's so good. I'm so excited.
Righteous.
He was before the law came. Before he did any work, he was considered righteous. Why? He just believed God would do what God said he would do. As Christians today, we just believe that Jesus did what he said he was going to do. That I will die. I will give up my life. And 3 days later, I was rise from the grave. I just believe that. My grace is sufficient for all your needs. I just believe that. Anybody else? But I'm going to mess up. Absolutely. Every day of the week. I ask Jesus, forgive me, usually every day. Usually minimum about 100 times. Okay, I mean, I'm kidding. You know, daily. I ask God not to re-save me, but I ask him, Lord, forgive me. Why? Just because sometimes I hurt my wife's feelings, and I have to apologize. And immediately she forgives. She's so much like Jesus like that. I want to be angry for 3 or 4 days, but she just forgives immediately. I need to be more like that. Me, I want to hang on to it. Because they deserve it. Hello? That first illustration, he deserves hell. All the terrible thing he did in his life, he deserved hell. But there were two different men right beside Jesus. According to Scripture, at least one of them yelled insults toward Jesus. If you're really the Son of God, come down and bring us off here too. And the other one yells at him, what are you doing? Don't you realize we deserve this? He doesn't deserve this. Jesus, will you remember me when you come into your kingdom? Could you imagine Jesus? I tell you the truth. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. I just want to say something happened at that moment, and that man believed Jesus. Hear what I just said? Something happened. He heard the words of Jesus and he believed. Dr. Rocco Piccarelli, I'm going to close with this. He says this about faith. It's really good. So I'm going to read it slowly. But I want you guys to grab on this. It's so good. Faith is not righteousness nor a substitute. Faith itself is not righteousness nor a substitute. He actually says, faith is not righteous nor substitute therefore. Faith is not work. This is huge doctrinal things. I want you guys to grab this. Faith itself is not work. Faith is not work and has no merit. Faith is believing, accepting, trusting God. But faith is man's activity. It's not God's. And faith is the condition required if one is to be counted righteous before God. Now, I like the New Living actually uses the word counted. Okay? Counted means a reckoned, regarded, imputed. Now, we don't usually use those three terms very often anymore. I'm quoting him. We don't usually use those anymore. But most of us, well, I hope you do. You guys, we still account for our checks that we write, right? We still balance that checkbook, that account. Because if you write something too big, it's not going to go through, right? We have to account for that. And if you work for somebody, there's things called year-end reviews. Anybody having one of those? Sometimes your company gives you a year-end review. You got to count for what you did. Okay? Counted means reckoning, regarded, imputed, put on one's account righteousness. You recall means right standing with God. So righteousness means right standing with God before the divine bar of justice. When Abraham put his faith in God, this entry was placed on Abraham's record in heaven, and he says, innocent. Or you've heard me say, not guilty. And so it is with every person who puts faith in God. Folks, it wasn't what Abraham did. We are saved by grace through faith. New Living says, we're saved by grace when we believe. It's not that any of us can boast. We have nothing to boast about. Abraham had nothing to boast about. We have nothing to boast about except for Jesus Christ and his righteousness. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, as we bow today, Father, we tell you thank you for your grace. Lord, if there's someone in the sound of my voice who's never repented of their sins, I pray in the name of Jesus that the Holy Spirit will call them to repentance. And right now, right where they're seated, that they would repent of their sins and put their faith in Jesus Christ. For only faith in Jesus can save us from damnation for all eternity. Only faith in Jesus can save us from the wrath you have, Lord, against our sin. Lord, I thank you for salvation. I thank you that you cared enough to think of me when you sent your son. Lord, I thank you that you cared enough to give your life, dear Jesus, on an old rugged cross so that we can know you in the power of the resurrection. I pray for our church family. We pray for that you will move in the hearts of people, that you will give them boldness this week as they're around family members to share the truth of Jesus Christ. Not only his love and grace and forgiveness, but of the wrath that is coming for those who do not repent of their sins. Give us boldness, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for being so good to us. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. I want to thank you so much for being here today. Reminders. No youth service Wednesday. We will have a combined candlelight communion service at 6 p.m. Please bring some refreshments, not a full-out meal, just refreshments to share. And then 4:30 is lineup. I'll let us know as soon as I know more detail about how to get the lights and stuff on the trailer again for Thursday. Food pantry 2 to 4, is that right? 2 to 4, if you can help out this Tuesday from 2 to 4. No Sunday school next Sunday. So if you show up at 9:45, just hang out. Praise team already be here. If you show up at 9:45 next Sunday, praise team will only be here. We'll all meet here in the morning worship together. No children's church next week, okay? If you'll stand to your feet.